Hello everybody. First of all, I would like to thank to Professor Safa Rıfat for giving me this opportunity. And also I would like to thank to Professor Yuradistov for his very nice presentation. My presentation will be in the similar topic. However, I will be more focusing on process and reactor design for thermochemical heat storage applications. I will be mainly presenting our works in past few years that we have performed at University of Nottingham and some works that I have continued since I moved to Cyprus. So if we start first, I just want to give some brief introduction about the importance of thermochemical storage application and why we need to expand our work on this direction. Mainly if we check, there are three different ways actually that we can benefit from thermochemical storage applications. One of them is we can use the on-site energy generation, electricity generation, which is excess that we cannot use and we need to store it. It gives us an opportunity to store it in thermochemical materials in thermal form and use it later. Second opportunity could be transportation of the industrial waste heat. This image is given from a project in the Germany where industrial waste heat is transported with trucks and used in another application. And lastly, we can use the off-peak tariff, off-peak low cost electricity to store it and use it later on once the heat demand becomes peak. If we look at the latest aims of the European Commission for 2030, we can see that around the share of renewables are proposed to increase 32%, also reducing the emissions by 40%, and also increasing the efficiency. So development of advanced heat storage methods are serving for all these purposes of the European Union. And as Professor Yuradistov mentioned, it can allows us to shift from electric-driven air conditioning and heating applications to thermal-driven heat storage or cooling applications. So first of all, if we look at the heat storage potential, I would like to present some basic results that we have done about the UK climate conditions. So we can see for the cold climate, such as UK, in winter period, even during the midday, there is no storable energy. However, in spring periods or summer periods, we have plenty of storable excess energy here. So if we can develop some advanced methods that can store the heat for long periods of time, we can keep this heat stored without the loss of energy, and we can use it in the required period of time. So if we have a look comparatively to different types of heat storage materials, including some sensible storage materials, some latent storage materials, and sorption materials, we can see these are representing a monthly coverage of a heat load of a building, a sample building that we tested here. Rather than the heat load of the building, I would like to take the attention to the percentage coverage with the different types of heat storage materials. This is actually representing a kind of heat storage density of different materials. As we see here, with calcium chloride, silica gel, or zeolite-based materials, it's a quite large percentage, whereas once you move to latent heat storage materials represented with green and red, it becomes a smaller percentage, and sensible storage materials are much smaller percentage. Here, this data is represented per meter cube of storage volume, and this gives us an idea that utilizing sorption-based heat storage is a more realistic approach to meet the heating demand of a building in terms of short-term or seasonal heat storage. So with this idea, we have performed some work on thermochemical heat storage applications. For the ones who are not in the field, just very simply discussing the idea, once we provide the moist air to the system, we might have a sorption bed here. Once we provide the moist air to the system, due to the sorption, physisorption process here or chemisorption, we generate the heat and the heat is released together with the air that we can use it in any heating application. Of course, during this sorption process, the material becomes saturated and it should be regenerated, which is performed through supplying the heat to the system and dissolving the moisture. So this reversible cycle could be applied for short-term heat storage or seasonal heat storage. One of the most important advantages is allowing us to store the heat without any loss of the energy over long periods. And this is the advantage of this kind of storage method once we compare it with sensible or latent heat storage. So different materials are available in the literature, mainly composite materials using different host matrices to keep the salt inside, and the adsorbent material, which is the salt here, they can be combined together by applying different methods. Also, chemical reactions, which are again water and salt-based composites, could be used. There are conventional adsorbents such as zeolite silica gels and liquid absorption processes mainly used in the absorption chiller applications. So in our research, based on the works pioneered by Professor Aristo, we have developed several different composites by impregnating salts in different host materials, as you see here. And we named them SIM material, which is called salt in matrix. So here, the list of the materials which we have studied in the past are given. If we look at some different alternative reactors which have been studied in the past, we can see a rotating drum reactor, modular design consisting of multiple trays. Here, the main important idea, whatever material we are using, important idea here is to enhance the contact area with the adsorbent and the process gas, which is mainly air, moist air. So once you use a rotating drum system, we can enhance the contact area, also reduce the pressure drops, or splitting the material into sections allows us a better contact area again, which enhances the reaction kinetics. We can use multiple reaction modules. Also, we can use different types of heat exchangers. This is a natural material studied by Liu et al. Also, impregnation of the coating of the heat exchangers for, again, sorption application. These are studied different reactor designs. So if we look at the materials that we have checked, the image is representing the salts. Here, this scanning electron microscope showing the salts impregnated in vermiculite. Therefore, we are using the vermiculite here as a host material where the salt is dissolving and staying inside the host matrix, and we are preventing any kind of leakage of the salt from the matrix, which allows us to perform the sorption process over longer periods. So here, once we look at the sorption isotherms, we studied different materials. However, I would like to take the attention of calcium chloride base, which show a good moisture uptake at low relative humidity levels, which shows that it is a potential candidate for us to be used in different applications of heat storage. If we look at the energy densities of different materials, we can see again, the first one is representing calcium chloride vermiculite, and the second one is representing magnesium sulfate. These two represented higher densities. However, if you look at the magnesium sulfate, you can see even at high relative humidities, the sorption isotherms are quite poor. Therefore, we cannot consider this material alone for thermochemical storage applications. So in a custom rig, we have tested different materials. Here, we have vermiculite-based samples, non-vermiculite-based samples, where we use zeolite silica gel or activated carbon as host matrix rather than the sorption material. We impregnated different salts. However, impregnation of salts in zeolite, silica gel, carbon provide less promising results compared to the vermiculite-based composites. As we see, SIM3A, which is calcium chloride vermiculite composite, show quite steady performance over repeating cycle. Therefore, it is considered as a good candidate for thermochemical applications. Here the results showing the cumulative energy output in our test with a relation of the mass uptake is shown here. As we see, different there are relations between the energy output and mass uptake of different materials. And here our proposes, I'm not sure if you can see it, if you move the cameras, on the right hand side it's seen. Our main target is to achieve high energy output with high mass uptake. However, mostly materials are showing low mass uptake versus low energy output. And any kind of attempt improvement to move this path to the right side of the curve is beneficial for us for improving the thermochemical applications. So, I think time is a bit limited. I don't want to spend too much time on detailed results. However, I just want to share that in this design, compared to our first design, we use embedded diffusers inside the reactor because, as you can guess, for heat storage application, you need quite large volume of material, and we need to think critically how to enhance the area between the material and the airflow. Therefore, we consider using these embedded diffusers inside material, and we achieve quite promising temperature increase compared to the initial testing results. And this gives us a good motivation for further advancing the research in this direction. And we come up with a different idea of using an embedded diffuser inside a pipe. Here, the main advantages are making the system simple, easy to design, low cost, and applicable in a real application. Therefore, we just use the pipe configuration where we have the perforated diffuser. And in these results, in these testings, we got quite good results. We compared the zeolite and calcium chloride vermiculite couple here. And here we see the zeolite is represented with black line and the vermiculite calcium chloride with the gray line. As we see, zeolite has slightly better absorption rate. However, once you come to the charging period at the applied regeneration temperature, while desorption rate for vermiculite CaCO2 is much higher rates, starting from 15 gram per minute, zeolite show poor regeneration characteristics at the given temperature. And this is also representing the need for new sorption materials which can regenerate at lower temperatures. So some other tests that we have done in this sorption pipe unit is one of them is showing the intermittent operation of the system, which has not been widely investigated before. Just assuming that we have a large storage volume of material, and in winter period we want to operate the system intermittently. So just operating for some time, stopping the system, then again starting after a while. What would be the system performance? We wanted to see this. And after starting operation, we stop an insulated system, giving a break, then continuing again. And we observe that system performance is actually quite similar to the continuous operation of it. And this is one of the important aspects, because in thermochemical heat storage application, we need to have an idea about the operating conditions of the system. We need to achieve as much as we can, we need to reach to steady state operation, which is not possible in heat storage application. However, we need to make it as steady as we can, and also we need to have an idea about the operating conditions. So in long-term operation, we tested the system at peak temperature reached to 60 degrees, which is about 40 degrees temperature lift. And as a result, we obtain around 8.5 kilowatt hour of energy output, which represented heat storage density above 250 kilowatt hours per meter cube, and demonstrated promising results. So one other investigation that we have performed is using integrating a vapor compression heat pump with thermochemical heat storage, which has not widely investigated before. Maybe it might look a bit odd once we first thought to integrate the heat pump and heat storage unit. However, we should think realistically, because in most countries, solar energy is even summer not available. Therefore, using a heat pump technology, which allow us to boost the heat with small amount of electric supply, is an advantage. And using the heat pump for charging the heat storage system here, which also allows us to recover part of the waste heat as a useful heat in charging, and supplying rest of the waste heat to the evaporator of the heat pump in a kind of applying heat recovery for this heat pump. And also in discharging process, directly sending the air to thermochemical storage allows us to have a quite interesting process, which might be possible if we have photovoltaic panels in our house to drive the heat pump during daytime with the photovoltaic panels, storing the heat and using the heat at nighttime, or alternatively running the heat pump at midnight once you have off-peak electricity and using the stored heat later on when we need. It gives us a flexibility to meet the supply and demand balance in buildings. So the concept that we investigated here is also shown here, the view of the experimental unit. We use a modular reactor. We can see the air inlet, air outlets. We use different materials, tested different materials in this configuration. And some results provided here. The most importantly, the COP of the heat storage process, if we investigated, we can see that at low humidity operation and high humidity operation, we can see that COP values above 1.2 is achieved. Here, COP value is actually representing the total heat recovered from the system to the total energy supplied to the system. As you are utilizing the heat pump here, we have, in a way, we have a heat storage efficiency greater than one, because we are using free energy input in charging process through the heat pump. Therefore, comparing to storing the heat just with an electrical heater, we have much higher storage performance here. A heat pump is allowing us to store the heat with very high efficiency. Therefore, this is one alternative method which could be considered in future applications. So we had done other testings as well about the bed thickness, changing the bed thickness in reactor. These were more process-based testings, or with different airflow rates. Increasing the bed thickness and airflow rate provided some advantage. However, the change was not dramatic. So we also tested later on different host matrices in addition to the vermiculite, calcium chloride, and zeolite. We have investigated using porous, aerated porous concrete material, which is used in construction actually as an insulation material, and also a pumice material, which is a natural rock available, and both of them are low cost. We impregnated calcium chloride and tested these materials in comparison to previously investigated materials, and they provided us quite reasonable result as well. Especially the pumice showed quite steady outputs, and we have idea of further investigating this host matrix, because in the literature I haven't seen studies about using pumice in thermochemical storage application. Basically, the main advantage of pumice compared to vermiculite is its rigid structure. Vermiculite is more like a spongy material, and once it becomes oversaturated, it can become mushy and stick together. However, pumice can provide some advantages, which I believe it's an important challenge, because once the materials stick together, the salt stick the material together, and it creates a very large pressure drop in the application. Therefore, we need materials which can keep their form rigid during the operation. And the last part, which we have studied last summer in Cyprus, as you know, Cyprus is good, has a very good solar potential, and we wanted to make use of it. And we developed a small scale reactor where we integrated the previously designed sorption pipe reactor with a concentrator, and we also preheat the air before entering to the reactor. Therefore, we both heat the reactor and the air together at the same time, because the regeneration is quite challenging, despite most of the work is just using electric heating for experimental purposes, testing material. In real life, we saw how challenging it is. We saw how challenging it is to regenerate the material. In our test, once we checked the hygrocyclic ability of material, which is actually representing the moisture removed in charging to the moisture loaded in discharging. So basically, what percent of the moisture we were able to remove that we absorbed in discharging. This result showing in first cycle, we had about 85%. However, it dropped to around 60-65% later on. Obviously, more testings are required, which is our future plan to continue to see in what point it becomes stable or if it becomes stable. The reactor temperature was around 80 degrees here. And at this temperature, we were only able to remove 60-70% of the moisture. And as a result, overall heat storage efficiencies were found around 25-35% in this range, which showed a slight decrease with the increasing number of cycles. Therefore, further work on making the system more compact, achieving higher temperatures. These are important aspects. And just very briefly summarizing, I think I kept it a bit long, summarizing the points. So thermochemical storage can store the heat around 6 times higher when compared to the sensible heat storage. In cold climates, short-term heat storage is not a very realistic approach due to the limitation of solar energy. In cold climates, interseasonal storage should be the main focus, where thermochemical storage serving a good alternative. With a good reactor and process design, by using vermiculite, calcium chloride, or the new material that we check, pumice calcium chloride, they can provide energy densities above 200 kWh per meter cube. And also, they have relatively lower regeneration temperatures when we compare to zeolite or silica gel, conventional materials. Designs using the embedded diffusers inside material can enhance the heat transfer area. Therefore, also, it can minimize the effect of the reaction front, which is preventing the airflow. It's partially eliminating these pressure drops as well. Therefore, it provides advantages. Another interesting design could be integration of the sorption pipe with concentrators. Of course, this arises some questions in larger application, how we can make modular or how we can make it in large scale, because it's difficult to use large volume of material integrated with concentrator. However, from my point, these sorption pipes could be designed that we can easily replace them, like the, we can say maybe the tube gas that we are using at home. It could be designed in a way which allows us to charge the materials in summer and use it in winter maybe. Another point is heat pump integrated thermochemical heat storage is a good application. This could be a potential application. And very basically the barriers of development of it, redistribution of salt in seams is a problem. We need to understand the behavior of the material. Seams becoming mushy, their physical stability should be increased, more rigid, structurally rigid materials. The wetted reaction front prevents the airflow. Pressure drops are important, negative aspects. Unsteady operation, weak system control, our insufficient knowledge on chemical properties of composites. These are important disadvantages, important barriers. So we can focus on, my point is we can focus on continuous operation, which we are moving the material rather than using fixed bed, moving the material somehow with using some mechanical low energy consuming devices such as halozones or some kind of belts, moving belts. This can enhance the performance. And that's all. Thank you for your attention. Thank you.
Thanks, Devran. Thank you. Very, very interesting. Very good talk. So, colleague, do you have any questions to Devran about anything you want to ask him to talk? Any questions?
So thank you very much, Devran, for your very interesting presentation, which is about materials. I spent a lot of time, maybe almost 30 years studying these materials. Composites, salt inside porous matrix. We proposed for heat storage in 1996. And this year, I finally finished and published this book about these materials, which also includes adsorption chilling and adsorption heat storage. So, but I have two questions. One is about pumice. How is this material is called? Pumice or yes, pumice? Pumice.
I think it's called pumice in pumice. English. Uh-huh.
It's something produced by volcanic activity?
Yes, Professor. Generally, like this is a kind of stone, like even near the seaside, some parts it's available like a natural rock. However, it has industrial production as well. Like they are using it sometimes for making the bricks, different bricks or concrete. They are using it as a material inside.
So it is commercially available?
Yes, Professor, it is available.
It should be cheap?
Yes, very cheap. Like, in fact, like when there is a company in Cyprus, I requested and they gave me for free, like, because they have huge amount of supply.
What is the per volume of this material?
It's around 5 micrometer
per volume, not per size.
Pore volume, actually, we haven't investigated it, but I believe it should be close to vermiculite range.
Ah, great, great. Okay, this is very interesting. Another question is about your system. So your heat storage system is open system. Yes?
Yes, professor.
In the sense that you should organize flux of air through the fixed adsorbent bed. Yes?
Yes, professor.
How much electric energy you use for organizing this air flux? Because there is a hydraulic resistance of the bed, and how much is respect with the heat you store it in the bed?
So comparing to the heat output per energy required to drive the air, it's quite small actually. If we just talk about for the airflow energy consumption, we can have 6-7 times more heat output. Comparing to our heat output, airflow is not consuming because the pressure drop is large. However, we try to minimize it with using different designs. However, if we check the overall energy consumption and calculate the overall storage efficiency, of course, it is quite low, like around 0.3, 0.4 range. Like the heat that we stored as a ratio of the total energy supplied for regeneration as well.
Okay, I see. Thank you.